I've been sitting here waiting for this light to arrive as the sun goes down. This light arrives, and so just very quietly sitting here for maybe the past half an hour. It's super important every day to now spend time sitting quietly, allowing your entire system to slow down. Because the world is speeding up. And if you don't do this, you're going to get caught into this speed up. And you're going to become dumb, essentially. You will only become smart about how to speed it up even more. You'll be into the speed up mode. You won't know how to slow down, actually. And you will even think that slowing down is crazy. Now this slowdown mode is extremely helpful. I've had astonishing results, actually. There's this inner patience that enables one to take a second look at truth, which is all important. Because we will dismiss truth preemptorily. We'll just say, that can't possibly be it. I'm not even going to look at it. You know, too impatient, we'll say. When we're impatient, we can look at truth and just say, I don't have time. This is ridiculous. It doesn't seem coherent enough for us to even bother. So what's happened with me is I've been able to slow down and be patient enough. So I took a second look. I took a second look without all these judgments of time. Saying, what are you looking at this for? You don't have time for that. And I just had enough, finally had enough patience and non-judgment to take a second look, a little closer look, a little closer look. And then when I did that, I said, hey, wait a minute. I see something here. This should not be rejected. This should not be rejected. I'm going to accept this. And this caused quite an astonishment. So you see, in all the traditions of people sitting quietly, you wonder, what's the big deal with that? It doesn't fit in with the modern world, does it? Not really. But what it fits in with is truth. That's what it fits in with. And since truth is always true, this always is the right thing to do. So since truth is always true, sitting in stillness is always the right thing to do. Since truth is always true, sitting in stillness is always the right thing to do. Keep this in mind. It makes all the difference. You're not too quick to judge. And in doing so, you don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. You say, hey, wait a minute, let me take a second look at this. Just because I'm not in a rush, under pressure, but pressure to get it right. So say, let's take a second look at this. Maybe you know, I just need to look at this again. Let me look again. There's a certain attitude that comes about on the spiritual path that enables one to come to the point of accepting truth on its own terms. Emmanuel, the shining light is with us. Accept it on its own terms. And then, that's when astonishment enters into the picture. So I'm just going through the continuity fear part of this astonishment. July 21st. In the morning of July 21st, I had this situation where I made this fundamental breakthrough and was quite astonished. And I'm just in the managing the wow phase, today, managing the wow phase of this. What I saw was pure genius, pure genius. That seemed to change the equation. Here, change the equation. Absolutely it did. Fundamental shift. Yeah. So, next 2 years. July 21st, 2:14, July 21st, 2:16. is going to be a time of fundamental shifts. So we asked for these times, and now they're here. See, this is what we need to realize. We asked for these times, and now they're here. So I have to embrace them, like the drought in California. It's here. I guess we asked for it. And I'm embracing it. I decided, you know, we're hardscaped, everything so much. Change the look of everything, totally transform the whole feel of the place into, it feels like, hey, this is a drought era. We're now in the era of diminished water. And this is a radical change, a radical shift. Before we were like, everything's luxuriant. Luxuriant. Pouring water on everything. Just look at this, we live in Eden. And now look at this, we live in a desert. It has been a radical, quick radical transformation, actually. Cut way back on the number of plants, you know, gonna cut way back, no garden, no, everything's been cut way back. And just, so this is the time we live in. Embrace the time we live in. And fortunately, I've been able to do this with the drought and just accept it. You know, this, it's not easy, but this is the time we live in. Don't battle it. So the time we live in the world is a time now of this fundamental shifts now are going to happen. Fundamental shifts. There's going to be a lot of shifting. Big time shifting, meaning could be big time earthquakes. Okay. That is true. Or the fundamental shifting could be at a deeper level. Okay. It may not work out on the physical level, these fundamental shifts. I'm not sure. But we are in the time. So we need to simply embrace that. We need to embrace it wholeheartedly and allow big changes, big astonishing shifts to happen. We're in the time of astonishment, actually. And I kicked it off this morning with an absolutely astonishing experience and embracing that. Say, okay, this, here we go. So just a heads up on this. This is the time we live in. And those who will be clinging to the past are going to miss it. Have troubles and be dragged down. Just like those who keep thinking that, oh, water, we got plenty of water here in California. We don't. See, it's a hard thing to come to grips with, but you have to stay on top of it. Now, those who have been watching this YouTube channel, I no doubt are ahead of the game, because I've been giving heads up for several years, saying, hey, we've got to get on top of this situation that's coming. Got to be ready for it. And the great shifts come when you're able to be silent for a prolonged period of time. I pointed that out in the last video. I got to get it up so you can see it. Get it online. Take off the private label and put public on it, because I it's processing right now. And it's the secret of meditation reveals something like that. It has to do with sitting. Why sitting quietly is so super effective. So if you haven't watched that video, check it out. Very important video for you. So paradoxically, is the less you're in a hurry, the more time you spend in this quiet sitting, the greater the shifts, the more astonishing shifts occur. You can have all these people constantly in a hurry like ants, you know, and nothing fundamentally changes at all. They're like stuck in a prison. What we're looking for now is the fundamental, huge shifts, title changes. That comes from extended blocks of time sitting quietly. where you're committed to not acting anything out, no action. And then these, you can work through so much. You say, I'm not acting on that, and that, that, that. And all your thoughts tend to drop away because you're not going to act on any of them. And then you're able to get deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And then you're able to see, like beneath the ocean, so to speak, beneath the surface. You're able to get beneath the surface. And that's where the astonishment takes place. The huge wow factors take place, and you're seeing, say, oh, wow. So this is what's required in the next 2 years, for sure. Cannot play for the little stuff anymore. Don't sweat the little stuff. Go for broke. Go for the big shifts. And in order to do that, you have to manage your success. You have to sit quietly, get to the wow of the inside. You're seeing it, and then you manage the fact that you've seen this. Once you've seen it, you know it's there. It's like once you look beneath the surface of the water, of the ocean, maybe with a mask on, and then you see, oh my gosh, I see what's there. And now when you put your head up back above the surface, you don't see it anymore. But you know, wow, I know it's there. Now, don't start trying to think, like, remember, like, what was there? I can't remember, you know, exactly how does it look? No, it's enough to know. You know it's there. You may have looked beneath the surface and you see this beautiful glistening submarine. You say, wow, I see it. You may see all sorts of stuff beneath the surface. But surface seeing isn't good anymore. You have to see beneath the surface. So that which keeps you only seeing superficially the surface and not below it, it is very much something that you need to get out of and avoid like a plague. Avoid it like it was the Black Plague. It's worse. It's a spiritual plague, so to speak. There is a spiritual plague upon the land, and as I say, there's a world war, a battle for your attention. The world is saying, keep your attention on the surface. And I'm saying, put your attention beneath the surface. This is the recommendation of spirit. This is what has to happen. Now, there's a lot of people who in the past have spent time, quiet time. They need to revisit that discipline and now bring it out of the closet and say, hey, it's time to really get back to this now. Yeah, I remember. There was a lot of people meditating in the past or sitting quietly, contemplating, sitting in stillness. And it's sort of gone out of vogue. But I think enough of us broke the ice, saying, you know, time to get back to that. time to do it now. Time to do it now, as a matter of fact. So I do see myself as helping out with that, as helping facilitate that for others at this time. That's sort of how I see my role. So less active role in the world in terms of doing things. The next 2 years more of a sitting. Well, I may be doing other stuff too, but certainly that's part of it, is sitting quietly, helping facilitate that. People need help with that. They need to say, I can do this. And just make a 2-year commitment. You know, what the world needs to do now is called a 2-year commitment. And just saying, for the next 2 years, I am going to sit quietly. It's not a question of, well, I'll try it, you know, maybe if I... No, I say, okay, I'm making a 2-year commitment. And for these 2 years, I'm going to spend as much time as possible sitting quietly. Because this is my life, this is what I want to do. This is something I want to see. Maybe this is going to, you know, be the remedy that I need. And you know, cut out other stuff, other behaviors. Go into hardscape, turn your life into hardscape, whereas everything's simplified. And you say, what's the one most important thing I need to do the next 2 years? Sitting still, sitting quiet, where you're committed to not acting on anything during this. When you're doing this, you're not going to act on anything. You're just going to sit quietly. This is the most extraordinary help, which is why I've been doing these long videos for all this time. You know, it's been enormous strain, because of course people don't want to watch long videos. They, you know, it's very difficult, but this is the strain that's necessary. Because whatever you can get in a short time, if you spend a longer time, you're going to go way, way deeper into, you're going to come across astonishment. Where it's just a huge pop of wow. It's so surprising, just astonishing. And yet you're committed to not acting anything out, so you can handle it. If you're committed to sitting quietly and not doing anything like this, pretty much anything can appear in front of you, because you're not going to act on anything. So something astonishing can appear in front of you, and you say, that's okay. I'm not going to grab it. I can't grab it. I'm committed to not grabbing anything. I'm not going to grab anything. I'm not going to chase after anything. I'm not going to leave my seat for any reason. So then, you will find out that astonishment, the breakthroughs will be truly astonishing. I mean, mean, if Jesus walked by right now, I'd remain sitting here like this. So anyone can walk by. It's not going to rattle me. And when I talk about being rattled, it's the great, the wonderful stuff. Like I said, what we fear is success. What we fear is great good news. But if we're committed to just sitting here, the great good news can come our way. And we just say, that's fine. Let's say a huge pile of gold suddenly poured down from the heavens here and was piling up. I would just notice it and just keep sitting here. Don't move. The heavens opened up and all the angels came pouring down here. Don't move. See, we're afraid of astonishing great news because we feel we need to act upon it. We need to translate it into some sort of action. And the great good news is so incredibly great. There's no way we can translate it into action. Because the great good news is we don't need to translate anything into action. There's no need. Reality doesn't have a need for anything to happen. Doesn't need any action to happen. How do you translate that into action? You cannot. You cannot translate reality into action. That doesn't mean you can't take some action, but it's not a translation of non-action. So you cannot translate truth realization into action. You cannot. But we're so obsessed with action and believing that whatever inspiration comes to us, we're supposed to translate it into action. Whether it's Thomas Edison, you know, trying to invent all thousands and thousands and thousands of inventions. You know, this is the land of ingenuity, the world of let's do things, let's invent things, let's translate whatever we can, every last bit of drop of inspiration, let's translate it into things, you know, into material actions here. And the spiritual path is the opposite of that. It's say, let's not translate anything here, because it's non-translatable. It does not translate into action. The vision of oneness does not translate into action. Not at all. Everything's already perfect, just as it is. It's absolute, complete perfection everywhere. How do you translate that into action? You cannot. It's ridiculous. again, that doesn't mean you can't take action. Certainly, you can sit quietly, that's taking action. You can go meet people, that's taking action. You can tell them the good news, that's taking action. But it's not a translation of the truth. No, it's not a translation at all. So when you see the truth, you have to be committed to not taking action in order to see it. Otherwise, you'll go crazy. And by going crazy, I mean you'll come unglued. And by coming unglued, I mean over time, the wheels will come off. You'll get out of control. Your mind will start racing, and you will find yourself becoming exhausted. That's why the West has had an extremely difficult time recently with the truth, ever since the so-called, you know, the period of disenlightenment. I call it the age of disenlightenment. They call it the age of enlightenment. It's actually the age of disenlightenment. The Newtonian, Lockean, Aristotelian beliefs, age of disenlightenment, where we think now we need to translate everything into action, into materiality and ingenuity, things, happenings, every, you know, action, action, action. We've had great trouble, so we looked for other areas of the world where there was still no demand to turn it into action. You see, that's why we a lot of people from the West began seeking in this other places, like, wow, is there anywhere where we can get free of this colossal demand that we're feeling, this monster? And so, but we've had a great trouble here in the West translating this into the West and accepting it. Great deal of trouble. Because we're so used to feeling it's a divine mandate of the Western world to translate this inspiration into some world-altering action here. But that completely blocks you from seeing deeper what needs to actually be seen. Completely blocks it. If you try to do it, as I did, you're going to come unglued. In the past, I had not yet been able to, you know, free myself from the demand for translating it into action. And I thought that by translating it into very high action, cultural, like beautiful music or art or whatever, that was okay. No, it wasn't. So I became aware of the deeper levels through the tremendous desire to help the world. But then in trying to, believing I needed to translate it into action, the wheels came off most severely. So it's taken a lifetime of effort to correct that situation to some extent here, perhaps to a significant extent. So the great breakthrough is to realize you don't need to translate into action. Reality does not need any action. Reality doesn't need any translation. There's another one. Reality doesn't need any translation. Reality doesn't need to be translated. Reality doesn't need to be translated. Reality does not need to be converted. Reality does not need to be transformed into anything. Reality does not need to be transformed into anything. So what do we got here? July 21st, August 21st, September 21st, October, to 3 months of, you know, nice weather. Yeah. Well, it's certainly time to get started on whatever we're going to do. We're now into the fullness of these times. And again, officially, like California says, officially there's a drought, folks. Restrictions officially, you know, it got to that point. It's never happened before where statewide restrictions and fines have been imposed, first time ever. So we're in an extreme situation, not just in California, everywhere in the world actually is an extreme situation, because there are intentions and forces, etc. in the world that are very extreme. We may think that the answer lies in some genius translating some inner knowledge into external action. No, the answer does not lie there at all. Just the opposite. It comes in acceptance of the truth as it is, that it cannot be translated and does not need to be translated into any action, into any process, into any purpose, into any endeavor. There's absolutely no need for truth to be translated in the slightest bit. That's what helps the world. That is what helps the world. Could you imagine all the people in the world spending 3 hours a day in quiet sitting and coming to gradually realize this, and they would stop thinking that they need to translate everything into action? Just could you imagine how wonderful the world would slow down? The massive uses of resources would slow down. Just everything would start to get simpler, brighter, clearer. The whole world would take a great sigh of relief. Ultimately, we'd realize we don't even need this realm at all. And the world could be set free, liberated from us, from our demands we place upon it. This is actually the right way to go. Enough inventions, more than enough. We have enough things. What do we need? We need a plate and a fork and a spoon. And a cup, maybe. A few other things are nice, but it's not like we don't have basic living figured out here on the planet, you know, let's be honest. What do we really need in order to sit quietly every day? Well, we need a little bit of food, a little bit of shelter, a little bit of sanitation, a little bit of upkeep. So it's not like we have to keep frantically trying to more and more action, more and more inventions, more and more ingenuity. It's not like we need constantly new models of everything coming out in the world, right? I mean, the washing machine we had 30 years ago was just fine, actually. So was the dryer. And people actually dry their clothes on clotheslines all over the world, too. That seems to work fine, right? We've got the basic appliances. Do we really need constantly upgrading, constant new models, constant new sophistication in every last thing in our lives? The answer is, of course, we don't. Do we need to constantly change our wardrobe? No, we don't. So at some point you say, you know what, it's good enough. Now it's time to get down to business. One thing they haven't changed is your body's falling apart, actually, you know. Getting older. I had my first senior moment today where I was working out in the hot sun. And I've been super weak, almost like a death's door, really. And having bad vertigo, just the whole body shaking and trembling, no strength, but I had to get stuff done. And I almost fell over. I just almost passed out, fell over. I had to grab something to keep from falling. And it's like, wow, that was cool. My first senior moment. So, definitely our bodies are aging, right? So we better make right use of time. I mean, you're gonna get to the point where your life's about ended and all you've done is just try to keep upgrading some foolish things, you know. How many different new water bottles have you gone through? Oh, there's a new one out. There's a new one out of this. Oh, you know, you go in a store and everything is like so incredibly new. It's amazing. I try to stay out of stores. I went into a, It's one of these fitness stores, super fitness store, actually. Bicycling, fitness, all, you know, types, yoga, everything. It's just like, everything was like so completely new, and colors and the packaging. It's that way everywhere. This is a grotesque waste of time, effort, focus, attention. It's imbecilic, actually. Extraordinarily imbecilic, driven by an extreme unrecognized continuity fear. When you recognize your continuity fear, all of that begins winding down a bit. And not all at once. And as you get older, too, you tend to be less interested in that and keeping up with appearances constantly. So actually, things get better as you get older in terms of being able to focus your attention better, actually. You can use it, age to your benefit. Some cultures have had traditions where once you're a householder and you raise the kids and they're out of the house and have their own lives, you know, then you spend time in spiritual contemplation, you spend time in quietness. That's expected and very much respected. You don't keep trying to keep up with the Joneses. No. We have this obsessional world now that we need to keep up with the Joneses. And at some point, you gotta say that enough's enough. So I would say these next 2 years, enough's enough, enough's enough. You say, you know, it's now or never. I mean, I'm going to either sink or swim. And you just make a commitment. Say, okay, I'm going to try and swim. Let's see if I can swim. You don't know until you try. Let's at least find out. And you say, hey, maybe I can swim. And that's good enough. Maybe I can swim. That's good enough. Because that defeats the effort here to prevent you from thinking that way, because that's a statement of attention. You're saying, maybe I can put my attention on swimming because maybe I can swim. So it's stupid for me to take my attention off of this and think that sinking is wonderful. It's like we're in the ship and the ship is sinking and everybody is saying, wow, I want to order a different drink. Let me order a different drink. Let me get different colored gambling chips. Let me put on a funny hat, you know. And then the ship's sinking. And people are obsessed with, hey, let me, you know, buy some, let me change my look. Let me get a makeover here. Let me do this. This. The ship is sinking. You're on the ship and it's sinking. Get in the lifeboats. Get out in the water, see if you can swim. Or get in a lifeboat, right? And you might need to swim. So people are obsessed with superficiality. The attitude. How many people died today, you know, over there someplace? Do you spend your time reading the obituaries? How many people about listening to the news? What kind of terrible crimes happened in the world today, folks? We really need to know that? I mean, hey, we're sinking. What else do we need to know? See if we can swim. We may say, hey, maybe we don't need this realm. Maybe we don't need this realm. Maybe we don't need to try and translate truth, reality, into action. And therefore, we don't really need this realm. This is the realm that encourages that, allows for it, encourages for it, you know, encourages it, and this is the place to go if that's what your thing is. But we can realize we don't need to. Reality doesn't need anything to be translated into any action. Reality doesn't need anything to happen. One way of saying that, paradoxically, a double statement, is to say reality doesn't even need reality. Reality doesn't even need reality. Need is the important word there. Doesn't need it. It is it. What is doesn't need. Doesn't need what is. It already is what is. See? Reality is already reality. It doesn't need reality. I'm getting this song keeps playing in my head. It wants to say something. It says, yeah, it's something about autumn time, leaves in autumn, and so, you know, possible there could be some leaving in autumn, this autumn time. Or it could mean leaves begin to fall, deterioration this autumn. When the leaves begin to fall in autumn. I'm not exactly sure which it is. So there's something coming up in autumn that is going to be very significant. So 90 days. 90 days. Till, I guess, the beginning of autumn, right? Yeah. No, actually, autumn begins September, 60 days, beginning of autumn. 90 days till we're full, a month into autumn. So when the leaves begin to fall in autumn, that's what keeps repeating in my mind, when the leaves begin to fall in autumn. maybe the people may be falling by that time. Or maybe that's a time of detachment. It will maybe we need to be able to detach from the world by autumn. I'll work on that one. Leaves fall in autumn because of the cycles of nature, the attitude of nature, so to speak. So it could be talking about a time coming up where the attitude of the world is causing stuff to happen, leaves to fall. So I say, what's going on? Ask within, it says, celicide. I said, what, you mean suicide? No, celicide. Celicide. What's that? It's a new word. People will commit celicide. What's that mean? It means going into a state of silliness. Once you go into the state of silliness, it's hard to get out of that. You've cut off the depth of your being. Cut off the depth of your being. The harshness, the pull of winter, pull of darkness, causing leaves to fall into leaves falling, silicide. Of course, evergreens are not going to fall. Evergreens are not going to be like that. Immune to it. So we need to shift into an evergreen, don't we? We need to shift our psyche into evergreen status. Shift our awareness, our attention into evergreen status. So I say that the pressure will be so severe that come this autumn that people will start succumbing to the pressure. They will start becoming very silly. And this is like a contagious, silliness can become contagious like a plague, actually. You already see so much silliness going on in the world, celebrating silliness instead of sitting quietly. So you don't have suicide, you have silicide. Silicide's even worse. Silicide is even worse because it's a spiritual, mental sort of situation where you feel cut off from the depths of your being, the true depths of your being, and you can only see superficially, and then you become than you've been to try and celebrate superficiality, and then you try to get a sense of depth through excess of superficiality, and that's what's called suicide. So we need to immunize ourselves from suicide. Okay. Okay. So maintain your dignity. Limit your silliness. Do not think you need to be hip, especially if you're older. Don't let the young people drive you into suicide. Don't try to keep up. Realize the right use of time. Say it quietly, more and more and more, where you're committed to non-action. It's very difficult in an activist world to be committed to non-action, but this is the highest teaching. This is the actual way that works. Be committed to non-action. Be committed to be unhip, uncool. I'm committed to uncoolness. I'm totally committed to uncoolness. There you go, there's an affirmation for you. I'm totally committed to uncoolness. I'm totally committed to unhipness. Totally committed to not keeping up. I'm totally committed to not keeping up. I'm totally committed to non-action. Start practicing this. I'll do a video. Practice these affirmations. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.